Hello, everyone. Thank you so much for coming tonight. It's really amazing to see this room full of people who really care about gender balance in tech. So this is the only animation I'm going to do the entire talk, so I want you to savor it. So please hold your questions and comments to the end. There's a lot to get through in the time, and we'll get to questions back at the end. Right after Girl Develop It comes on, I'll come back up for questions. Is that correct? Yeah, OK, cool. And these slides will be available online. So I'm going to go over things pretty quickly. There's a lot of information on the slides, and there's links. So don't worry if you miss something. So this is a multifaceted problem that has many angles we can come at it to create a solution. And all of them matter. I wouldn't say that any matters more than the other. The pipeline's important. Working on improving culture is important. Working on improving public opinion is important. Working with male allies and public policy. And there are many other facets, too. So I'm talking about male allies specifically tonight, not because it's the most important thing or the only thing, and not because men are to blame, but because men are in the majority in tech and in the majority of leadership positions. So if they understand how to be effective allies and advocates for women, that can go a long way to creating a more inclusive environment. And with diversity and inclusion, you know, we talk a lot about women in tech, but there are lots of areas of diversity and inclusion, like race and ethnicity, sexual orientation, issues of accessibility, disability, and socioeconomic mobility, and other areas as well. And so by talking about women, I'm not saying any of these things is more or less important. They all matter for diversity and inclusion. It's just I can't talk about everything all at once, and so the talk is focused tonight on male allies and specifically on gender. So please close your eyes. I'm going to take you through a guided visualization. So I want you to picture a woman. Make that woman not someone you know or some celebrity, but just a woman you're imagining right now. And now imagine a group of women. And imagine that those women are diverse in race and ethnicity, sexual orientation. Imagine that there's transgender women among them. Imagine that these women have disabilities. And imagine that they come from various strata of society. And imagine that all of that diversity reflects all of the diversity that we have in women in Columbus. And now feel a connection to these women. Feel that their fate is tied to your fate. When they succeed, you succeed. When they struggle and hurt, you struggle and hurt. Now, every time I say the phrase women in tech, that's what I want you to be picturing, is this diverse group that represents the women in the city that we're living in right now. And as you feel your compassion for these women and their lives, I want you to also turn that compassion around and feel that for yourself. Okay, open your eyes. So it's important to feel compassion for yourself when you're working to become a better male advocate and ally, because it's a learning process. And like any learning process, you're going to make mistakes and there's going to be bumps along the way. So it's hard and it's complicated, but in another way, it's simple. Like any learning process, there's just three steps. Educate yourself, make mistakes, learn some more. And just keep going through that process over and over again, keeping a growth mindset and keeping compassion for yourself. So when you're educating yourself, reading extensively on the topic, turning to female thought leaders that have put themselves out there as leaders on this topic is a good thing to do too. Sometimes men turn to women that they work with or women in their lives and ask them to educate them on this topic. And while that can be useful, it can also be a little bit loaded. If you're asking a coworker to tell you about gender inequities and difficulties around gender, the reality is she might not feel safe enough to do so. And it might be an undue burden on the women around you to sort of push them into this role if they're not volunteering to do so. So make sure that when women have stepped into leadership and are offering to educate, that those are the women that you turn to. And some men get discouraged when they come up against, they tried to do something good and it backfired and they give up. But like any learning process, don't give up when you fail, because that's when you're growing. And turn to other men that you know. You know, look around the room here, the men that came to this talk, and build a network for yourself of other men who are working on this, and use each other for support. And overall, you'll have a positive impact. So speaking of female thought leaders, most of us here are probably on Twitter. Think about who you follow on Twitter and who you retweet. Research shows that men are more often followed and more often retweeted on Twitter. So this is a website where you can go and put in your Twitter handle, and it'll tell you the gender balance of who you're retweeting. So it's kind of an eye-opening thing to do to see if you're paying attention equally to men and women. And throughout the talk, I'm going to be mentioning female thought leaders that you can follow on Twitter, so feel free to follow those. So some research shows that a certain percentage of men, about 13% of men, think that as women advance in the workplace, that means less opportunities for them. But research has shown that that's not the case. The gender balance is a win-win for everyone involved. Gender balance leads to higher levels of innovation, smarter teams, higher levels of creativity, problem solving, better products, more empathy, more connection to a wider range of users, greater societal good, it's good for the economy, on and on. So when you think of the workplace as a limited sized pie with only so much to go around, then scarcity thinking can make you think, well, if women get ahead, men won't. But the reality is that when there's gender balance and everybody feels supported and included and can be themselves at work, the pie just gets bigger. I liked this. It's from Ernst & Young's campaign to raise awareness around gender balance. So recently it came out that based on current projections, it'll take 117 years before we have gender-balanced boardrooms. It doesn't have to take that long if we change things, change the direction, and work together. Something I liked about this was the better the question, the better the answer. And that's something that I use in my life, asking myself powerful questions to motivate myself to change. So how can Columbus, Ohio become the first city in the United States to achieve gender balance in tech? I think that's a powerful focusing question for us. I think we all care about the tech community here, and we all care about gender balance in tech. So how can we take a leadership role on this? Recently, there was a ranking of the best cities for women in technology. They looked at 54 cities with at least 200,000 residents and cities with a large enough tech workforce to have statistically reliable data. I'm realizing my voice is getting louder every time. Sorry about that. So unfortunately, we currently ranked at 52 out of 54 cities. And we can do better. Raise your hand if you think we can do better. So just for perspective, this is Columbus, Ohio. When given two choices of gender on the last US census, this is how people broke down. 51.2% are women. Sean, is it possible that I could get my slides here so I'm not turning my head when I... Sorry. This is another slide for context. So when looking at what happened to women in computer science, a lot of people don't realize that women were entering computer science at a faster rate than men until 1984. These other lines here show other majors that women continued to enter into after that point to about level of parity, but in computer science there was this dramatic drop-off. And Planet Money looked into this, and what they found that correlates with that time period is the mass marketing of home computers, and they were marketed as toys for boys and men. And the theory is that that set in motion the stereotypes that have impacted our society and snowballed into who were the original founders and then our, you know, what showed up in our movies and pop culture around who was a tech creator. And so that's for... And these aren't the most significant things that have happened over the last three decades, but this is just to sort of put it in some time scope. In 1984 was... It's not going to happen? Okay. I was clicking through it before on my on the screen here, no? Okay. So in 1994 is when the Grace Hopper Celebration of Women in Computing was founded, and in 2004, of the firms founded in the U.S., 19% had women as primary owners, and only 3% of tech firms were founded by women. And 2014 was the year that major tech companies finally became public after a lot of pressure from activists to reveal their diversity numbers, and that transparency has catalyzed a lot of positive action. So when Sheryl Sandberg was asked this question of how men can better support women in tech, she listed three things. And the first was to educate yourself and others about unconscious bias. Do you want to play that?
The unconscious mind is amazing. It can process vastly more information than our conscious mind by using shortcuts based on our background, cultural environment, and personal experiences to make almost instantaneous decisions about everything around us. The snag is, it's wrong quite a lot of the time, especially on matters that need rational thinking. Here's a classic example. A bat and a ball cost £1.10. If the bat costs £1 more than the ball, how much does the ball cost? Most people, including over 50% of students at some of the world's leading universities, get the answer wrong and say 10 pence. The answer is actually 5 pence. Many of us choose 10 pence without thinking. This is because our unconscious mind uses instinct, not analysis. So our unconscious is fallible. It's also biased. It makes snap judgments of people we meet, categorizing them according to gender, social, and other characteristics. In milliseconds, we judge whether somebody is like us and belongs to our in-group. These are the people we favor. So men might favor men, while women might favor women. However, we can belong to different in-groups, and we like to be part of an in-group that's powerful, which could mean a woman favoring a man over a woman. That's unconscious bias. All of us have it, and it colors our decisions without our realizing. For example, research reveals that if I were a man, you would be more likely to be nodding in agreement right now because people pay more attention to a male voice. The Royal Society fosters excellence in science, but this can only be achieved if we select from the widest range of talent. And that's not possible if unconscious bias is narrowing down the field for non-scientific reasons. To lessen the impact of unconscious bias, which is easier for us to notice in others, we are raising the awareness of unconscious bias to members of our selection and appointment panels. We're encouraging panel members to deliberately slow down decision-making, reconsider reasons for decisions, question cultural stereotypes, and monitor each other for unconscious bias. We can't cure unconscious bias, but with self-awareness, we can address it.
These are some other resources for reading about and learning about unconscious bias. So it's been shown that we can reduce unconscious bias. Research has shown that by studying it and paying attention and slowing down our thinking, we can find ways to intervene. Some people have studied if unconscious bias trainings in the workplace actually work to shift thinking, and they don't work in isolation. They have to be combined with other things. They can ready people for cultural change, but they don't just work on their own. So when we come around to inclusion, what we're really talking about, a major part of what we're talking about, is the feeling of belonging. Who belongs and who doesn't belong in tech? And when people feel like they don't belong, that can wear them down and harm them and make it hard for them to want to stay in an environment. But then we often find belonging by sameness. We have a bias towards people who are like us, and then we think that they belong. We have to think beyond that unconscious bias of people that like me belong here, people that are not like me don't belong here, because uniqueness is the quality that creates diversity. And so valuing people because of difference and saying that they belong because of their difference, that they're bringing their difference to the environment, makes it stronger and more vibrant and brings all the good things that we talked about earlier with the research into gender balanced environments. So the costs of somebody feeling like they don't belong and having low ascribed social status in a group are costs to their mental functioning, costs to their physical health and well-being, costs to self-control and motivation, and ability to persist in the face of challenge is damaged by feeling like you don't belong. This morning I was invited to OSU to hear about their Allies for Women Engineers program, and I'd like to invite two of the men from that program that presented to come up now. It was really inspiring to hear them talk. These men are going through a training inspired by White Men as Full Diversity Partners, which is an organization that helps men become better allies and advocates. Come on up. Okay, here, stand a minute. Yeah, just who you are and the definition.
Hi, my name is...
It's not on? Got it? Okay. No?
Yeah. Okay. All right. Hi, my name is Steven Mozaki. This is Aditya Jalamar. We're from our student group on campus, Allies for Women Engineers. We're working to address the chilly climate that's faced by engineering students, specifically at the undergraduate level. Something that Ms. Kinsey asked us to address today. So when we're working on our project, we needed a framework to scope our work and our efforts. So we adopted the definition of an ally from Broider, who does work in social justice for allies. And in that, she describes social justice allies as members of the dominant social groups who are working to end the system of oppression that give them greater privilege and power based on their social group membership. So in this case, for us, the dominant social group would be males in engineering. And working to work on, like I said, the chilly climate that human students have to face. So,
cool. Will you speak about the microaggressions piece?
Oh, sure. So I'm Aditya. So we're both part of Allies for Women Engineers. And so microaggressions are kind of implicit things which female students, in our case, face. In the College of Engineering, we had a study that was performed in 2012, which kind of indicated that there was an issue which needed to be tackled, and that was kind of the basis of which our program was started. And we're hopeful that, you know, we can make some progress in addressing, as Stephen said, the chilly climate that female engineering students specifically face at the College of Engineering at Ohio State. Is that
that? Okay. Do you want to say more? Okay. Great. Thank you.
All right. Thank you.
So one thing that during that talk, they passed around quotes from women in engineering, things that they had overheard, things that had been said to them, things in the environment that made them feel that they didn't belong. And so those things seem little in isolation, but they add up to creating a hostile environment. And so something that male allies have a lot of power to do that might be harder for women in a tech space to do is to speak out when these things are said, because of unconscious bias, men are more likely to take other men seriously and more likely to dismiss a woman's concerns as being over-emotional or invalid. So I think that it's wonderful that these men are doing this work at the university level. If you want to talk to them about their experiences afterwards when we're networking, I highly recommend that. So research has shown that feeling like an outsider is one of the big reasons why women leave tech. And so paying attention to what are the things that we do on a daily basis that make each other feel like insiders or outsiders, and just these little wearing down things. So one of my people that I follow and am inspired by her work is Karen Caitlin. And she is behind this Twitter account that I highly recommend following. It tweets in the voice of an ideal male ally with great suggestions for things to do. So if you're looking for inspiration on an ongoing basis, it's a great thing to connect with. And she was at the Grace Hopper Celebration of Women in Computing when there was a Male Allies panel. And there was a group there that was tired of male allies who seemed to be only having a superficial understanding of the issues involved and perhaps using the mantle of male ally to promote themselves and not really to do the deeper work. And they had passed around this bingo card of cliche things that male allies say. The people in the audience were shouting out bingo when the guys said enough of the things. So Karen wanted to create something that was a more positive, useful approach, where she created a bingo card where men can use it as, you know, inspiring, I do, you know, these are the things we want to hear as women in tech that you're actually doing, that you're committed to doing. And so you can find this online, Tech Diversity Bingo. I've used this as, this is out there on Creative Commons. I've used this as inspiration for a lot of the parts of my talk up ahead. So one of the squares on the bingo card is, I insist that conferences I speak at and or attend have a code of conduct. If you are curious about why a code of conduct is important for gender balance and gender inclusion, there's a link here. And again, these slides will be online. Publishing and setting clear goals for gender balance is another powerful thing you can do as a male ally. If you're not in a decision-making role in your companies, you can advocate for it. You can support it when it happens. Paying for expert diversity advice and trainings. Again, if you're not in a decision-making role with each of these things, use your voice to the best of your abilities. When hiring a consultant, when the company hires a consultant, if you're not in a position to hire, be supportive of that work. Bring in an outside expert on an important topic is an important thing to do. I'm not a consultant myself, so I'm not saying this to promote myself. If you're looking for ideas for who your company should bring in, I have a few women. These are women that you should definitely follow on Twitter as well. and these slides will be up. Another slot on the diversity bingo card is being a listener. So a lot of what I've heard from women is that when they finally get up the courage to tell a man in the tech space about something that's happened to them, often it's dismissed. And so know that if a woman is doing that, she's doing that at risk to herself. And it's important to take the time to really listen and understand and be supportive. Tracking retention of women is a key signal of whether you're succeeding at being an inclusive environment or not. Looking for leaks in the pipeline, not only in training, but in moving up through the company. So when you're thinking about gender balance in tech companies, thinking about it at the entry level, in specifically tech roles, in leadership, on the board, looking at all areas, and making sure that the promotion process is fair. And this is another from the bingo. Speaking up when you see discrimination or exclusion, training yourself in understanding unconscious bias and microaggressions and following the thought leaders I've mentioned will help you be able to identify this. When research is done, women see these things more than men, and that's an artifact of privilege. If you are not on the receiving end of something, sometimes it's hard to see it. But once you open your eyes and see it, then it's important to figure out how to speak up. And I know that's dangerous to do. There can be negative repercussions for anybody who speaks out about something that they see. This is a link to suggestions for how to handle situations like that. And then also seeking out support of other male allies is a great thing to do to make speaking up when you see something easier. Some resources for that are MARC, Men Advocating for Real Change, White Men as Full Diversity Partners, and a group called He for She. Another square from the diversity card is separating true requirements from nice to haves. Is just an example of ways that you can put out job listings that aren't gender biased. So this is another link to how to avoid gender bias in your job listings. This is a thought leader to follow on this. She created an application that you can use to help when you're writing your job descriptions to make sure that they attract the highest quality candidates, but also there's a feature that'll show you if the language is skewing gendered. She has a PhD in linguistics and has held product and design leadership roles at Microsoft and Amazon, and has authored several studies on language, technology, and document bias. So there's real science and research behind the concept of gendered language. I know that can seem strange if it's a new concept, but it's real. I check for diversity before agreeing to speak on a panel. This video is from a local woman who started this organization called Speaking of Gender. She's another great person to follow and learn from.
Speaking of gender, we are a citizen action group that champions gender balance and equality.
Our mission, ensuring women are included in leadership and speaking roles in both professional and public programs.
We provide action steps for individuals and organizations to include more women in public dialogue.
Become a partner for gender equality.
Sign the Parity Pledge. Why? To support women in speaking positions.
Why? Because women of all diversities are underrepresented.
Because it is important that individuals use whatever influence they have to create a just and more equitable world.
When you sign the Parity Pledge, you pledge to use your voice and influence to ensure the representation of women and public dialogue. You will convene meetings, conferences, and panels that include women, encourage diverse perspectives and insights, and value gender and racial balance. Share your expertise and include yourself in the Speaking of Gender Speakers Bureau.
We are encouraging all women's voices, races,
ethnicities, ages, backgrounds, classes, genders,
sexualities, abilities, and educational backgrounds.
Don't forget to like our Facebook page. And you can find us online at speakingofgender.com.
So if you're a woman, raise your hand if you are willing to be a public speaker. I often hear men say they can't find women who are willing to speak. So look around the room. Here they are. They're everywhere. Another way to be a great male ally is to mentor and go beyond mentorship to sponsorship. Studies show that women are over-mentored and under-sponsored. The difference is the sponsor will advocate for the person that they are supporting and vouch for them beyond just, you know, teaching them. And prevent and address bias feedback in hiring and promotion is another thing that you can do as a male ally. And this link can give you ideas about how to do that. Here's another resource. And Lean In has some great resources for male allies, for in work and out of work. And this is a great book.
Cabinet, you said, looks a lot like Canada, and I understand one of the priorities for you was to have a cabinet that was gender balanced. Why was that so important to you?
Because it's 2015.
I just love that. All right, girl development time.
Caitlin Steiner, and this is Jan Dennison, and we are the chapter leaders here for Girl Development Columbus. And first off, thanks to Columbus Web Group for having us here, and also thank you, Lauren, for sharing your stage with us. All right, we're gonna just run through this really quick. So here's our mission. Like Lauren said in the beginning of her talk, there are a lot of different issues facing the gender imbalance in tech, and there are a lot of different ways to combat that, and the way that we're going to do that is through education.
I have notes. Lauren's presentation was excellent and couldn't possibly give better suggestions for how to help the situation that we're in and where we are in it now. That dip that you saw in the 80s, before we figured out it was because computers were marketed to boys, people came up with a lot of suggestions for why that would be. And so women hear anything from women, you know, shouldn't be developers, to women can't be developers, women don't want to be developers, women wouldn't fit in with us, or women would fit in with us, they want to, they can, but there's just nobody out there now. So it goes from the overt to the subtle, and it does happen now. We want to think that, you know, overt sexual things or sexist things are a thing of the past, but I personally have had a CTO, as a developer, a CTO asked me to act as his secretary for a meeting for the afternoon because because I have pretty handwriting. So these are things that women still hear now today, and the founders of Girl Develop It, when they started this 5 years ago, they were told women don't want to and can't learn, and so they set out to prove that wrong.
And actually, in the last 5 years, we've definitely proven that wrong. Through the 54 different chapters in the United States, Columbus being one of the oldest, there have been 60,000 students that have gone through GDI courses. That's a huge number, and we're really proud of that. So just real quick, this is how Girl Development as an organization and a community operates. We never, ever assume that women aren't interested. That 60,000 number should show you pretty quickly that that is not the case. We work with women who are 18 years and older, so people who have maybe been under the impression their whole lives that this isn't something for them. It just never occurred to them, or they were actively discouraged from getting into tech in the first place. And we are a wide open community. We do not discriminate. Men are absolutely welcome in our classes and at all of our meetups. We love our male allies. They are awesome. We cannot do this without them. So some of the ways that we are hoping to bring people in and teach them more about tech and about our community is by lowering the barriers to entry. So we hold courses. They're very affordable. They're very small class sizes. We pay our teachers, and we have a very high teaching staff ratio to students. So for every 3 students, we have a teaching assistant, which is wonderful. And at all of our meetups and at all of our events, we just remind everyone that all of their questions are valid and welcome. And we strive to make the community as welcoming and warm as possible. So now talking about all of our meetups, this is our schedule for this year. This is all the stuff that we have set out to do. What you don't see on here is the 2 monthly meetups that we hold every month, which is a hack night and a coding coffee. So these are all of the things that we are setting out to do in 2016. And I would especially like to point out in the event column, we've only got 1 event so far, but it's a big one. Like I said, we are one of the oldest chapters of GDI. We've been around for 5 years. We were founded by Jen Myers, who might actually be coming to join us for that party. We're very excited. And it's going to be held here at Cover My Meds. So thank you so much, Cover My Meds, for hosting us. We're very excited. All right, so now back to you guys, since you're all here to learn how you can help women in tech. Here's one way you can get started, actually today, if you'd like. We are looking for teachers and teaching assistants. Like I said, we pay our teachers, but aside from that, we are an entirely volunteer organization, and so we reach out to the community to help for as much help as possible. You don't have to have any prior experience. Just reach out to us, and we'll get you all set up. As for students, if you know of anybody who might be interested in really really great, solid curriculum that starts from square one and is inclusive to all sorts of students, they can join the meetup and look for our upcoming schedule that you just saw. If you're interested in volunteering, we've got a lot of opportunities to do that, and we have a cool little bit.ly link there that I just created today, and I'm really proud of it. So bit.ly/GDIC volunteer. You can go fill that out right now on your phones if you want. It's so cute. And finally, sponsors. Scholarship fund. We offer scholarships for our students. Please. We're also looking for sponsors for that upcoming party, which will be held here at Cover My Meds. So here's all of our info. Thank you all so much for listening, and here's Lauren. The party, by the way, is March
9th. Oh, thanks.
So I'll run the microphone to whoever asks.
Okay, cool. Is this still on? No. Hello? Okay. Okay, so are there any questions, comments, diatribes, anything? Jill?
Hi. So what you talked about was so important, and I think you really hit upon a lot of different things that matter, that make up climate, that is hostile to women. But I think what I kind of want to hear more about are some more examples of what makes up this hostile climate. Because like you talked about with the unconscious bias, that everybody has that, so they're not necessarily bad people, or necessarily clamoring for overt actions, but things like not recognizing women's ideas in meeting, per se, to the same degree that you recognize men's. Or if you walk into a room and nominate men with a big hello, but then barely saying hi to the woman. I mean, those are things that oftentimes men won't recognize them as being clamoring, but over time, like we talked about, their accumulation. So can you give us some more examples? Because I thought you were dead on with so many things that you were talking about.
So with micro inequities, different from microaggressions. So an example of a micro inequity that is, have you ever, think about if you've ever felt unsafe walking to your car after work. And usually if you ask that of men and women, women are dramatically more likely to have that experience. So just subtle things like that can create a climate difference for women. And then microaggressions can range from, off-color jokes that or hypersexualization of women. And these things can just create an environment. And they can seem small and innocuous, but add up over time. Helen.
Just a couple of other examples to that. So I've been to conferences where I've been with my team, and they're all male, as it turns out, because I'm in security, which is like the least diverse of technology people. And the salespeople all come up, and they shake hands, like extend their hand, and they shake hands with every guy in the line, and go over me and shake hands, and they still do it today. And the nice side of my brain says they're doing it because they don't know whether I want to shake hands or not, and they don't want to get in my personal space. And the nasty side of my brain says that sales dude is not going to get any money. So there's that kind of thing. I think the other thing, in the office, men have a tendency to take up way more physical space than they should. And women have a tendency to not take up a whole lot of space at all. So when you're sitting around a conference table, you look at how people are using their space. It's like being in the middle seat on an aircraft, and you've got two people who really should have two seats on either side of you, and you're squashed in like this. Women get squashed in physically. And then when they talk then to the rest of the meeting, that physical presence doesn't always translate into being fully heard or understood. So,
good examples.
So I just wanted to throw in an actionable suggestion for men in tech specific. One thing that is very gendered behavior when you are coding with someone is taking manual control of their keyboard. Just here, let me do it. It turns out it happens to everybody and everybody's done it, but it happens much more frequently to women. And it also involves a violation of their personal space. So you're not only taking their stuff, but violating their space there. So that's one thing that we recommend to be aware of when you're working with people, is to be respectful of their space and say, hey, do you mind if I just type this in real fast?
Lawrence, first of all, thanks a lot for your talk. I think one thing that you said that kind of struck a nerve with me was on the team that I have, my direct team is about 60% women. There's not a lot of us, but it's about 60% women. And, you know, I feel like in the work environment, everything's pretty good. I feel like we, some of the things you mentioned, I feel like we're doing a good job of that. But one thing that I thought of was when I go outside of work, when I'm actually outside of the building, so if we're a conference, we're meeting with a sales team, and that dynamic changes, and so there are more men there, and maybe there's men that, you know, normally I would feel comfortable talking to and saying something different to, but because of the relationship I have with them and how it's tough, it creates this environment that's hard for me to be an advocate for them, for women in my group. And I think, to me, just hearing you talk about it, it's, I probably need to be a little bit smarter about the places that I do go to and maybe the people that I choose to meet with outside the building, because we would make a better environment for my whole team. So,
that's great. Yeah, very good. Thanks.
Awesome presentation.
Thank you.
So just kind of wanted to talk through some things that people can proactively do. So I'll throw one out there but then we'd love to hear some other suggestions that you have on how can you create a safe space for people who are diverse to speak up and feel welcome. One thing that I proactively try to do in meetings is when you see somebody not talking, you'll notice sometimes that a lot of times women are less aggressive about speaking up. Minorities can be the same way. And one way to make people feel safe is just to ask them, what do you think about this? And then people feel welcome to speak. Another suggestion is on collateral materials on the website, just to show diversity. When people see your site, they just instantly, subconsciously feel more welcome. And then that creates a better environment. What are some other things that we can proactively do?
Anybody have any more suggestions?
I think it's so important that you, both you and Caitlin from Girl Development mentioned that there are women in tech and acknowledging that we're here. A recent example of a different meetup I went to, not Columbus Web Group. we were going over some basic APIs. And I was sitting in the front row and had talked to the presenter. And three times during the presentation, the presenter said, "We're all men here." Hi. So I think acknowledging that women are here, and when it's brought up that, oh, the issue is in tech or because there aren't women, combating that.
Anybody else?
Yeah, I mean, I've been in IT for 18 years, and unfortunately, these situations occur every day at City. And we had a situation that, but it's all been in, this is like 3 days ago, and we had a meeting. And one of the executives from one of our courts, she was, you know, offering feedback, and the individual just kind of didn't hear it. And so I think it's important just to call them out, because after the meeting, we said, look, this is unacceptable behavior, and you can't, this is not how we work. So sometimes you just have to call people out.
Great.
And just say, this is unacceptable.
Thank you. Anybody have any more suggestions about how to create an inclusive environment for women in tech? Just the little everyday things.
I actually have another question.
Okay.
I was actually wondering what male allies can do to call out bad behavior. Like, what are some ways to approach that? Because there are situations where you don't want to be there. You don't want to be the person to jump in and end up burning bridges or...
Yeah, it's tricky. So Adam, you just gave that example of speaking up. Were you scared to speak up? Were there potential negative ramifications of that?
In this instance, it was a little bit easier because it was a contractor working for us. But it is difficult to say it's to save your boss or someone you're working with. But that's a trial and error type thing because sometimes you get burned, and I've gotten burned from calling people out and saying, no, maybe we should try this as a different tactic. So maybe it's suggested versus just saying it's a problem.
Right, and talking to somebody in private versus saying it in front of a group so that they're not shamed, so that they have a opportunity to grow from what you're saying and not feeling embarrassed and attacked.
So this isn't really text specific, and I think it's really small, but it's still a difference. When talking about specific topics that are most people would assume are gender specific, I think opening up and listening to both sides and both opinions is really helpful. A writer in advertising, and I was asked by mail to write for No Shave November, and I've never had a beard, but I raised the awareness for prostate cancer, which I've also never had, and it was an experience to work with a male who was supporting me, knowing that I'm either one, capable of lying really well, or two, just that being able to listen to people around you, you can still get a good experience and a good opinion from both sides.
That's really loud. So I kind of come from a different environment. So I was a teacher. I was a college teacher for a while for business class. For business classes are mostly you guys. So like I had a class that was 20, like total 40 people, and there were a bunch of girls. So what I'd like to say is like it's good to be mindful that you want to make sure that people who are minorities in your get a chance to speak, but you also want to be mindful that you're not putting the spotlight on them. So like you're not always saying, oh, let's have the girls speak out, because if you're always saying, oh, let's hear like, I don't know, Sandra's opinion about this, that's going to make them feel more isolated because you're always making them out for being different. So you have to be careful to walk, like it's kind of like a fine line between paying attention to people whose voices aren't often heard and putting them in the spotlight more for being different because they aren't being heard.
Yeah, that's good.
I was going to say, she stole my line. You can talk to people privately about things that they've done that are awkward or create that bad dynamic. Think about it like confronting somebody who owes you money. You're gonna be embarrassed when you call them out.
Yeah.
So you're in the high side. You know, you've got the high road on that conversation.
So I was going to ask a question about, so when we're talking about this, I think a lot of we're talking about emotional intelligence and those values, they definitely resonate more from a U.S. perspective, but certainly when we're talking about IT in an international community, I'm curious in giving this presentation to a diverse male audience, if certain things, how maybe that's translated or not.
Yeah, being aware of people's cultural filters around gender issues. Wow, that's a big topic. What do you want me to address?
Like maybe if you've gotten certain responses or...
Oh, yeah, yeah. So this is my first time. This is my first time giving this particular talk. So does anybody here have any insights into talking about gender in a very diverse, you know, from people from different cultures? Calvin?
If it's an international thing, I feel like, because I've worked with a lot of different countries, that
In the U.S., we spend a lot more time talking about diversity. So I worked in France last year, and they're completely like racial and gender blind. They don't ask about it on applications. They don't want to know. So they don't talk about it at all. Even though they would say that diversity is like at some point important to them, they think it's better to be blind to it. So like you have to be. It's hard to figure out how to approach an international audience until like you actually talk to them and figure out where they're coming from, because like. We approach the situation much differently than a lot of cultures do.
Yeah, that's a great question. I've noticed that within African-American business groups, sometimes there's some sensitivities around diversity as if it were a zero-sum game. So it's important to table as diversity is about inclusion, it's about growing the pod. It's not zero sum, and I think there is a difference there.
Yeah, definitely.
Oh, sorry. So you talk about unconscious bias.
No.
So it seems like it needs to be done when people are young in all the schools. So it was put into some kind of audience that you do for all grades, and you have a speaker up there, and they send letters out to the parents. It seems like if you did that with in every school, colleges, it seems like it would go into unconscious bias, and it kind of people would automatically just react like they should react.
Yeah, that's great. I think that would have immense value, because the more we understand about how our minds work, the better it is not only for diversity and inclusion, but for learning and processing the world. And I think there's a lot that hasn't reached popular awareness yet.
That's a very good point. One of the reasons I made sure in Chicago to get back to Columbus and get involved with a company that made some of the cool tech girls, just very much to that point. And being involved with PERBA and running with that now is a huge, huge advantage, because what it allows with that teaching is it allows us to have a long-term view of it. A lot of what we've talked about tonight is gut check, reaction. Someone says this, I say this. Someone does this, I feel this. Mm-hmm. But when you are just like a project, what am I going to say? You're practicing the right habits. You're practicing, how can I show the proper respect? And just proud to be part of the Cool Tech Girls piece, as well as to be involved here.
Great, thank you. Should we wrap up? One more? Okay, we'll take one more.
So we've talked a lot about hostile climate. There's a lot of biases within how people evaluate work. Jenny, you talked a little bit about, can you expound upon that, on how do we evaluate men's and women's coding abilities differently? How does that matter for promotion? Because we're really talking about mobility, too. For women to be able to go up the ladder and to be able to effectively make change when they have power. So can you talk a little bit about how bias also affects promotions and how we view work?
Did everybody hear recently there was women are better coders as long as people don't know their gender? Raise your hand if you read that article. Yeah. So it's becoming more in public awareness that, you know, there's this bias happening. So just the awareness piece is an important part of the people that are doing the evaluating, slowing down their thinking and making sure that they're checking for bias. And also standardizing what the bar is and making sure that they're consistently holding the same bar for everyone, regardless of gender. And then in the slides, there's a link to, you know, a site where you can find more suggestions about doing promotion well, but those are just a couple ideas. Great, thank you. Thanks so much for coming again, and thanks for a great conversation.